Okay, good morning all. Am I audible? Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, yes, okay, sir. Thank you. Okay, thank you. So in the last class, I started discussing the conformal mapping. So I have given the idea about the conformal mapping and isomonal mapping. So just if you have any kind of doubts, you could ask me before I proceed further. Otherwise, I'll discuss after that. So just I'm summarizing whatever I have discussed. So geometrically, whenever we are considering a function of complex variable is actually transforms a two-dimensional geometrical figure from one Argand plane to another Argand plane. So here Z Argand plane is considered as the domain and W Argand plane is considered as the codomain. So while we are defining a function W equals to FZ, so each and every point from the Z Argand plane is mapped to some points in the W Argand plane. So the independent variable which we are considering in the Z-Argand plane, if we join them, we will be getting a two-dimensional curve. Similarly, if we join their corresponding images in the W-Argand plane, we will be getting another two-dimensional curve. So here we could think that the function W equals to FZ is transforming a two-dimensional geometrical figure from Z-Argand plane to W-Argand plane. And in the last class, I have also discussed about the conformal mapping and isogonal mapping, and I have given the example of isogonal mapping. So whenever we are considering two different curves in the Z-Argand plane and they are intersecting at the point x0, y0. So by virtue of the mapping, each and every point which is over the curve C1 and C2 are mapped to some points in the W-Argand plane. So if we join their images corresponding to the points of the curve C1, it is giving us C1 prime, and the points which is over C2 curve is mapped to C2 prime curve. And they are intersecting at U0, V0, where U0, V0 is image of x0, y0, which we are obtaining by virtue of the function. Then if the angle between C1 and C2 is preserved in W plane, that means the angle is same in magnitude as well as in direction in both the Argand plane, then we'll be saying that the function is the conformal mapping. And if the angle is preserved in a magnitude, that means the value of the angle is same, but the direction is different. Direction means we can measure the direction of the angle along anti-clockwise direction or clockwise direction. So then we say that this is isogonal mapping. So I've given the example of an isogonal mapping, W equals to FZ equals to Z bar. W equals to Z bar is an example of isogonal mapping. Okay. So today we'll be discussing how to check whether a given function is a conformal mapping or not. So like the methods or theorems we have studied to verify whether a given function is analytic or not, here also we'll be studying about different theorems through which we could actually verify whether a given function is a conformal mapping or not. So while we are dealing with the conformal mapping, there is a close connection or relation between the conformal mapping and an analytic function. So let f be an analytic function. So we know how to verify whether a given function is an analytic function. So if f be an analytic function in the domain D and the z0 is a point where f dash z0 is not equals to 0, then f is conformal at z0. What does it mean, f is conformal at z0? That means if two curves intersect at the point z0, then their corresponding images, that means the images of two curves in the W Argand plane, will intersect at some point w0, where w0 is the image of z0. Then the angle between the two curves which is intersecting at the point z0 will be preserved in the W plane in magnitude as well as in direction. So if we can verify whether a given function is analytic function or not, and at the given point where they are intersecting, if derivative is not equals to 0, then obviously the function will be a conformal mapping. Okay. So then the reverse is also true. That means if f is conformal at the point z0, then converse of this theorem, the previous theorem, will be satisfied. That means f will be analytic. So far we have studied two theorems to verify whether f is analytic. So one is the Cauchy-Riemann equation, another is the harmonic function property. That means if f is a given function where u and v both are satisfying the Cauchy-Riemann equation and the partial derivatives of u and v with respect to x and y are continuous, then f can be analytic. And secondly, if f equals to u plus iv, where u and v both are harmonic, then f will be an analytic function. So these are two tools to verify whether a given function is analytic or not. So by the conformal mapping also, we can verify whether f is analytic or not. So if f is conformal, then it will be analytic. And if we know that f is analytic and the derivative at the given point is not equals to 0, then we can say that the function will be a conformal map. Is that clear? Have you understood? Is that clear up to this?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Then we'll be discussing a few examples of the complex valued function and their corresponding geometrical significances. So all these kind of functions you have studied either in mechanics or in geometry also, you have studied this in a coordinate geometry. So these are all known functions. So we'll be discussing how we can define those sort of functions by virtue of the complex valued function, and we'll try to interpret their geometrical consequences or significances. So one is translation. What does it mean? Translation means, say, if an object is here, then we are not changing the angle. Rather, along a straight line, we are shifting it. Say, let's say along this straight line, we are shifting this object. Then after a few shift, it will be coming here like that. That means this object is coming here. So this sort of mapping is called as a translation. So whenever we are defining a mapping through which we could identify translation, that is fz equals to w, that is u plus iv, that is denoted by a plus z, where a is a complex value, complex number. So that means z is shift to a plus z. That means a amount of translation we are providing to that object to shift it from its previous position to the newer position. So here z we are considering in the z-direction plane, and their shift, that means the translation we are measuring with respect to the w-direction plane. So here fz equals to w, so that is a plus z. So since a is a complex number, so it can be identified at a plus iv. So a plus iv, a is its real part and b is its imaginary part, and z equals to x plus iy. So if I segregate the real and imaginary part, I'll be getting a plus x plus I into y plus b. So here xy is the initial position of the point. So that we are considering in the z-direction plane. So its corresponding image is actually x plus a comma y plus b. That is our uv. So that means z is here. So this is the coordinate x comma y. So we are actually changing it a amount in the x direction and b amount in the y direction. Then this will be the position of newer thing. Okay. So since it is a plus z, so you know that we can identify a complex number by virtue of its positional vector. So say this is the z vector, that means the initial position of the object or of the point which we are considering as z. Then it is shifted at a plus z amount. So if I consider it as a positional vector, so you know the vector addition, so it is actually starting from origin, so it will be shifted along the origin. So a amount shift we are providing here because the angle is not changed here, angle is actually preserved. So we are translating this. So a amount of shift we are providing, and then it is coming here. Okay, so actually if you consider the triangular loss, so that is z, that is a plus z. So the initial position or initial image of z will be w. So here you can consider that we are shifting this, or we are dragging this throughout the same line along this real axis. So that is the newer position. So that is the geometrical significance of the translation. So you have studied in mechanics. So by virtue of this function, we can identify the translation, and geometrically this represented as this. So is it clear? Have you understood this, or do you have any kind of doubts? Is that clear or not?
Yes, sir.
So if you have any kind of doubts, you could ask me. If anyone have any kind of doubt, so I could repeat this again. Otherwise, if it is clear, then I'll proceed to the next. Is that clear, or do you have any kind of doubts?
So could you repeat it once?
Okay. So let me discuss it in the plane. Can I see the blank page?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so translation means, let's say this is the axis and this is the initial position of the point. So this is a z. So we are shifting, we are not changing the angle, we are shifting along the straight line. So this is a newer position. Sorry, this angle is changed actually. Like that. Is that clear? Is that clear or not?
Yes, sir.
So if you consider the parallelogram law, then this will be this sort of thing. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
So this is the position vector z. So this is the amount of shifting we are providing. So z means this will be z. So z plus a is actually w. So this is a w, new operation. So if I consider this as a function of complex variable, so fz equals to w, that is actually a plus z. So z is here. It is mapped to w. So how would we be shifting here? So z is here. We are shifting along the straight line, and it is a newer position. So this is w. So this is z. That is a, and this is w. So that means we are translating this point towards this point. So this is actually the image of this point. So this image of this point we can identify by the function that is defined by this. So how we can actually denote this if we use the coordinate geometry? So this is f of x comma y, and this is will be a b plus x y. So that is actually a plus x, b plus y. So you can identify this as, so this is a z-argon plane. That is the coordinate x comma y. So x means this distance is x. This distance is y. So a plus x means it is shifted to this amount. So this is a amount. So this is now a plus x. And y plus b means this amount. So this is y plus b. This is b amount. So this will be now the newer position. This one. Is that clear? Is that clear or not? So this is now the newer position. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So by this we can actually identify the translation. The next comes rotation. Rotation means, you know that without translating, we are rotating a position of the point by some angle. So you know that we can identify complex number z in the form of the polar coordinate. So by polar coordinate, we could write down this in the form of r e to the power I theta. Z can be identified in the form of r e to the power I theta. So the rotation is defined as fz equals to w. So we are rotating this point z alpha amount. That means e to the power I alpha into z. So z can be identified in the polar coordinate as r e to the power I theta. So this will be actually r e to the power I into theta plus alpha. So that means initially z is this. So e to the power I alpha z, that means alpha amount of rotation we are providing to this particular point so that it can be rotated. So this is the position vector z. So we are providing alpha amount of rotation in the anti-clockwise direction. So if I provide alpha amount of rotation in the anti-clockwise direction, then it will be coming here. So actually this portion will be fixed actually. So this portion is fixed. So this is the positional vector. So now the positional vector is just shifted alpha amount. So this will be the newer position w. So by this we can identify the rotation. And if I want to use the property, then it is coming here. So z means this angle is theta. This angle is theta. So initial angle is theta, and this is the r. So r is actually unaltered. That means this length is unaltered. So just positional vector is shifted here. So this is theta, and alpha amount of shift we are providing, and this is coming here. So in that way, we can identify the rotation as the complex valued function. That means we are providing alpha amount of rotation. So alpha amount of rotation, since we are providing, it is coming back here. Is that clear? Is that clear or not?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Is it clear to all of you? If you have any kind of doubts, you could ask me. These are all known kind of thing. You know about these functions in the real coordinate geometry. Also, you have studied this, the translation, rotation, magnification, like that. So just we are identifying this in the complex plane actually by virtue of this function. And since here we are trying to identify the geometric properties or how we can interpret geometrically complex valued function, that's why I'm discussing all these things. Is that clear? Is it clear to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then magnification. Magnification means just the positional vector will be either enlarged or will be squeezed. So magnification means we are magnifying the amount, magnifying the positional vector of the point. So initially the point is actually z. So by virtue of this function magnification, we are providing just some multiplied portion with this complex valued function. So a is multiplied with z, and ultimately we are getting az. So a here is a real number. Since we are magnifying this, we are not multiplying it with a complex number. Just we are magnifying the positional vector. So initially z is here. So if I identify z in the polar coordinate system, you know that this will be r e to the power I theta. So r is actually mod z. This is the length of the positional vector. So the length of the positional vector will just be increased since we are magnifying this. So that means in the same direction, the position length of the positional vector will be increased. So the length is actually here mod z, that is r. So this is actually n plus a amount. So this is magnified actually. So this is called as the magnification. So by virtue of this function, by virtue of this complex valued function, we could geometrically identify the magnification. Was that clear? Was that clear or not? Have you understood how we are defining the magnification?
Yes.
So here, actually, the position of z is unaltered. Just it is enlarged actually. That means the length of the positional vector is actually increased here. Okay. Then inversion. Inversion means just we are taking the inverse of this point. That means initially it was z. So we are considering or converting this in 1 by z. So that is a function, complex valued function. So this complex valued function is denoted as inversion. That is fz equals to 1 by z. So z can be identified as r e to the power I theta. So this will be 1 by r e to the power I theta. So that is actually 1 by r e to the power minus I theta. Okay. So that means it is actually, initially it was z. So it will be converted to 1 by z. So here previously, this is z means r e to the power I theta. So the length of the positional vector is r and the angle is theta. So then here the angle is actually just reverse. That means minus theta. So that means we are measuring the w, or we are actually identifying the image of this z here in the opposite direction. That means angle is measured in the opposite direction. So that is minus theta. And if here r is less than 1, so 1 by r will be greater than 1. So then it will be actually increased. That means the length of the positional vector will be increased. If r is greater than 1, then 1 by r will be less than 1. So then it will be squished actually. So here there are two changes. So one change is the angle is actually we are measuring here in the anticlockwise direction. If we measure here in the anticlockwise direction, then here we need to measure the angle in the clockwise direction starting from the origin. And if here r is less than 1, then 1 by r will be greater than 1. So here the length of the positional vector will be increased. And here the image that we have shown here, r actually greater than 1. So since r actually greater than 1, so 1 by r will be less than 1. That means length of the positional vector will be squished actually. Okay. So can anyone just tell me, whenever we are defining this function, is it a conformal mapping or isogonal mapping? The inversion at origin? Is it clear how we could define inversion? Is it clear or not? I need to repeat it.
It is clear.
Okay. Now,
so, over here, does the shape of the this figure change?
Yeah, shape of the figure will be changed because here we are actually considering one point, z, and we are measuring how it is getting changed. So if I consider a two-dimensional object, since the positional vector may increase or squeeze, so that's why it will be distorted. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
So now just tell me whether this mapping through which the inversion is defined, whether it is an isogonal mapping or conformal mapping.
Sir, is it isogonal?
Yeah, it will be isogonal mapping because here the angle is same, because previously the angle was theta for z, and here the angle is minus theta. So in the magnitude, the angle is same, that is theta. But actually here we are measuring the angle in the reverse direction. That's why the angle is minus theta. So in the previous cases, this here the angle is reversed actually. So this is actually a conformal mapping. And here it is not a conformal mapping, not an isogonal mapping, because here angle is not fixed. The angle is not fixed in the magnitude, because initially the angle was theta and now the angle is theta plus alpha. So angle is getting changed in magnitude. So there is no scope of this function for being the isogonal or conformal mapping. And here this is the example of conformal or isogonal or nothing.
Conformal.
Yeah, this will be a conformal mapping because it is just translated in the same direction. So the angle is not getting changed. So it will be a conformal mapping, and it is neither conformal nor isogonal. And this is conformal, and this is an example of isogonal mapping. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then there comes linear transformation. So in the first year, you have studied actually linear transformation. So here we'll be defining the linear transformation. So there you have studied this linear transformation in the form of the real functions. But here we'll be identifying the linear transformation in the complex plane. So how we can define the linear transformation? So linear transformation is actually the combination of translation, rotation, and magnification. So how we can define this? So fz is defined as here w. W is a plus bz, because you know that linear transformation means linear transformation is defined. How we can define? So a function f, if I consider here in the real plane, so if function f or a transformation f, it's called as the linear transformation. If f of xy equals to fx plus fy and f of cx equals to c of fx, that means f of x is actually x is transformed to c of fx. And here, so here both magnification and translation is involved. So since magnification is involved, so z is multiplied with v first, then we are providing the translation. So by this, the linear transformation in the complex plane is defined. So here a, b, z all are complex numbers. So a we are fixing here, then b is actually a complex number. So b will be identified in the polar form as b e to the power I phi, and z is identified as here r e to the power I theta. So if I multiply that, so and simplify it, so it will be a plus b r e to the power theta plus phi. So here, since originally it was e to the power theta r e to the power I theta, that is z, but here phi is added with it, the angle. So it is actually the rotation. So phi amount of rotation we are providing here, and initially the length of the positional vector was r. Now b is multiplied with r, so that is actually magnification, because the length of the positional vector is getting increased here. And after that we are adding a with it, so we are providing translation also, a amount of translation. So we can say that the linear transformation is the combination of magnification, rotation, and translation. So it is initially z, so z is magnified first. So this is b mod b amount of translation we are magnification we are providing, mod b actually b. So mod of, we know that mod of z actually here r, so here mod of b capital V will be small b. So mod of capital B amount of magnification we are providing, then argument of b, that means phi amount of rotation we are providing, then a amount of translation we are providing. So from origin it will be translated a amount. So in ultimately the position of w, that is the image of z, will be here. So linear transformation, you know the definition of linear transformation will be this. So if function f will be linear transformation if these two conditions are satisfied. So this can be interpreted in the complex plane as the combination of magnification, rotation, and linear translation. Is that clear?
Sir, so yes, the magnification of the object will depend on b, the small b, right? The whether the image is getting
enlarged. Magnification will be dependent on actually b, capital B. So b is a complex number. So since b is a complex number, so any complex number in the polar form will be identified in the form of its magnitude of the positional vector and the angle. So this is b to the power I phi. So magnification will be b amount. Since b is a scalar, r is a scalar, so b r will be multiplied together.
Yes, sir.
So first we are providing the magnification, so it is enlarged. Then we are providing the rotation, so it is coming back here. that is argument of B, that means phi amount of rotation, then again the translation with respect to the origin. So linear transformation is here is not a conformal mapping, or it is neither a conformal mapping nor a isogonal map. Is that clear? So the linear transformation which you have studied in the first year in the real plane, so in the complex plane, can be defined as this and can be interpreted geometrically like this. So this is the geometrical concept of a geometrical representation of linear transformation. Okay, is it clear?
Yes sir.
So then there is one more thing, that is a fixed point or invariant point of transformation. Invariant point means the point which is mapped to the same point, that is called as a fixed point. That means if I consider a function, with respect to this function, the points which will be mapped to the same point, they are called as a fixed point. So how we can identify the fixed points? So let's say fz equals to z square. So we can identify the fixed points by considering this equation, z equals to fz. Since this is a fixed point, so each and every point z will be mapped to the same point z. So the points z for which z equals to fz are called as the fixed point or invariant points. So say for example, if we are considered the function fz equals to z square, so what will be the fixed points on this mapping? So we need to consider this equation fz equals to z, that means z square equals to z. So z will be 0 and 1. So under this mapping, only 0 and 1 are the fixed points. So if you put 0, 0 will be mapped to 0. If you put 1, so fz will be 1. So apart from these two things, no other points will be a invariant point. So fz equals to z square. So if you put here 0, 0 square is 0, 1 square is 1. Apart from these two points, if you put any other points as z, you will not be getting the same point as z square. Okay, so these two are only the fixed points. So we can identify the fixed point and invariant points of a given function by this. So this can be asked as the MCQ. And the previous previous geometrical concepts or geometrical functions which I have defined, they can be asked in the exam also. Say for example, define translation, linear transformation by a complex valued function and identify its geometrical representation. Then you need to define in that way, like that. The question will be coming from here. So in the next class, I'll be discussing actually different examples of conformal mapping. So the function will be provided to you by the theorems. You need to verify whether this mapping is a conformal mapping. And if it is a conformal mapping, then what is its geometrical significance? Okay. So in the next class, I'll be discussing about some examples of conformal mapping. Is it clear up to this, what I have discussed till today? Is that clear or not?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So let me take your attendance manually first, then I'll be sharing the Google Classroom code. Okay. Rule number one, IIML. Rule number two, three.
Present, sir.
Four.
Present, sir.
Five.
Present,
six,
sir.
Six. Seven.
Present, sir.
Eight. Nine.
Present, sir.
Ten.
Yes, sir.
11. 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20.
Hello, sir, all 17 is present.
18, 19.
17, sir.
Yeah, given. 19, 20, 21.
Present, sir. 21.
22, 23, 24, 25, 26.
Yes, sir.
27, 28.
Yes, sir.
29, 30, 31, 32.
Present, sir.
33.
Present, sir.
Present, sir. So 33 present.
Yeah, given. 32, 30. 34.
Present, sir.
35. 36.
Present, sir.
37.
Present, sir.
38. 39. 40. 41.
Sir, 40 present.
40 given. 41.
Sir, 39. Sir, 39 present. AIM.
Okay. 41.
Sir, 38
present AIML.
38, 39, 40, then 41.
41 present AIML.
42.
Present, sir.
Present, sir. 44.
Present, sir. 45.
Present,
sir.
46. 47.
Present, sir.
48. 49.
Present, sir.
50. 51, 52, CSB is roll number 1, 2,
present, sir.
3,
present, sir.
4,
present, sir.
5,
present, sir.
6, 7,
present, sir.
8, 9, 10,
present, sir.
11,
present, sir.
12.
Present, sir.
13. 14.
Present, sir.
15. 16.
Present, sir.
17.
Present, sir.
18. 19. 20.
Present, sir.
21.
Present, sir.
22. 23.
Present, sir.
24. 25.
Present,
26,
sir.
26, 27.
Present, sir.
28, 30.
Again, sir.
31.
Yes.
32.
Present, sir.
32.
Present, sir.
33.
Present, sir.
34. 35.
Present, sir.
36. 37.
Present, sir.
38.
Present, sir.
39.
Present, sir.
40.
Present, sir.
41.
Present, sir.
42.
Yes, sir.
43. 44.
Yes, sir.
45.
Present, sir.
46.
Present, sir.
47. 48.
Present, sir.
49. 50.
Present, sir.
51.
Present, sir.
52.
Present, sir.
Sir, have you marked roll number 11, AIML?
If you have responded, then obviously I'll mark.
No, sir. Actually, sir, my mic was having a problem. I was unmuted, but I can't speak.
Okay.
Sir, roll number 15 as well. Sir, actually, I had also unmuted, but I think because you were so far, my voice was not audible to you.
I've heard your voice.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Sir,
sir, some people had written in the chat that they are unable to unmute.
So while I'm giving attendance manually, so I can't see the chat boxes. So let me share the link, exam link. So these are the exam link and this is the code. So just click the code and provide your full enrollment number and exam code and finish the class test by 11:30. There is someone from CSBS and AIML, just check and let me know whether you can access it right now or not.
It's working for CSVS.
Okay, thank you, Abhishek. Abhishek. And anyone from AIML?
Yes, it is working for AIML.
Okay, thank you, Soptik. Okay, so finish the class test by 11:30. So thank you all for attending today's class. Have a nice day. I'm leaving. Thank you.